First, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present this talk. There are various observations that indicate that there should be a form of matter other than ordinary matter that we know of. This form of matter is called dark matter because it doesn't radiate light. Let me just mention one of these observations, which is the rotation curve of stars in a galaxy. Here, the vertical axis shows the velocity of stars in a galaxy versus the distance from the galactic center. As you see, the velocity of stars increases with distance. All the luminous matter inside the galaxy is not enough to hold these high-velocity stars in their orbit. So, you know, dark matter has been introduced to provide extra gravitation to hold these stars in their orbit. Observations show that nowadays dark matter comprises the majority of matter in the universe, something like 5 times more than ordinary matter. Depending on the mass range, dark matter particles can impact structure formation differently. From this consideration, light dark matter, lighter than mass of the electron divided by 1,000, is already ruled out. In order for a particle to behave as a suitable dark matter candidate, it should satisfy several conditions. It should be neutral, it should be stable, and its interactions and production mechanism should be such that can account for observed abundance of dark matter. Among the particles that we know of, only neutrinos have these properties, but neutrinos cannot be suitable dark matter particles because they are too light, and as I told before, such light particles as dark matter candidate has been ruled out already. Moreover, within the standard Big Bang scenario, the abundance of the neutrinos are predicted to be too low to account for dark matter abundance. So one should look for beyond the standard model to find a candidate for dark matter. There are a lot of papers in the literature that suggest a candidate for dark matter. In most of these papers, the dark matter candidate is taken to be either a scalar or a fermion with a mass around 100 times the mass of proton, 2,000 times the mass of proton. Moreover, the interactions of this particle is taken to be weak, thus the name WIMP, standing for weakly interacting massive particle. There are good reasons why WIMP is such a popular scenario. First of all, within such a range of parameters, dark matter abundance can be naturally explained within thermal freeze-out scenario. We have some hopes for both direct and indirect detection. Moreover, such particles can be produced at colliders such as LHC at CERN. We are hoping that they are produced. Well, this is a very simple and minimalistic model and beautiful, but I want to raise this question. Has Mother Nature promised us to be always simple? Let us go back to the list of particles that so far has been discovered, including this Higgs particle that recently has been discovered at the LHC at CERN. As you see, the list is relatively lengthy. There are fermions, there are bosons, and fermions come in three generations, and nobody knows why. It is not so minimalistic. Now, let us focus on nature in its common sense, the world around us. Most of these particles are unstable and live only very shortly, and they show up only in exotic places like in colliders or in interaction of cosmic rays with atmospheric particles and in early universe. But the world around us is mostly composed of photon, electron, and nucleons, which means protons and neutrons, which in turn are composed of up and down quark and gluon. But look how beautiful is the nature around us, and I think that you will admit that it is far from simple. Beauty comes from complexity. In my opinion, it will be really a pity if the dark sector, which happens to be the majority, is so drab and dull. Let us be a little bit more technical. The gauge group of a standard model is SU3 cross SU2 cross U1, which is not, again, very simple. But let us focus just on this SU2 cross U1 part, which is electrovish gauge group. And this is the gauge group that Professor Salam, the founder of ICTP, had a great role in its establishment. This gauge group, in addition to photon, which was known, predicted three extra gauge bosons. Two of them being W bosons, which lead to charge currents, which is responsible for beta decay. When the gauge group was proposed, W boson directly was not discovered, but its indirect effect was known since late 19th century. But surprisingly, this group predicted another gauge boson, which was neutral, and as we heard on Monday in Professor Rubia's talk, was not discovered back then. It later on showed up in Gargamel at CERN. So the message that I would like to convey is that maybe minimalism and simplicity is not the proper guideline for building models. These are some ideas to make dark sector less boring. Maybe there are multiple dark matter candidates. There is no reason to believe that dark matter is elementary. Maybe it is composite. We have not so far measured the spin of the dark matter, so there is no reason to restrict to a scalar or fermion particle. The spin of the dark matter can be one, for example. This is one possibility. And finally, there is no reason not to restrict ourselves to 100 to 1,000 times mass of proton. Maybe dark matter particles light, for example, as light as electron. There are other possibilities to make dark matter a little bit more interesting, in my opinion, which has been discussed in the literature here. I have only listed the ideas that I also have worked on and somewhat contributed to. In the rest of my talk, I will focus on this possibility. There are two great mysteries before particle physicists. One is nature of dark matter that I already discussed about, and the other is smallness of neutrino masses. In the old standard model, neutrinos are massless, absolutely massless. But recent observations show that neutrinos have a tiny but non-zero mass. The ratio of the neutrino mass to electron mass is very tiny, something like of order of the mass of a butterfly to that of an elephant. There are many mechanisms in the literature which has been proposed to explain this small but non-zero mass for neutrinos. My collaborators and I tried to link these two mysteries together to explain both the smallness of neutrino masses and provide a candidate for dark matter, and we came up with this idea. Our scenario is based on this effective Lagrangian. We add a new fermion and a scalar. We impose a two-symmetry under which new particles are odd, but standard particles are even. As a result, the lightest one, which we take to be the scalar, becomes a stable and a suitable dark matter. We call it SLIM, which stands for scalar as light as MF. The Z2 symmetry forbids Dirac mass for neutrinos, but at one loop level, neutrinos acquire a Majorana mass. Moreover, the scalars, these five particles, the dark matter particles, can be produced via a standard freeze-out scenario with main annihilation mode to neutrinos, neutrino pair and antineutrino pair. Putting together the constraints from neutrino masses and observed dark matter abundance, we reach these constraints on the parameters of model. You see that the new particles that we added turned out to be light. as light as electron. What really excites me about this scenario is that we also find a lower bound on the coupling. This means that this cannot be set arbitrarily small, and this what excites me is that this means that the scenario is eventually testable. For example, it should we should be able eventually to find these particles in searching for rare decays of mesons. The new fermion that we added, as I said, is light. So this particle cannot have electrophilic interaction. It should be a singlet. So this Lagrangian that we started with should be only effective and can be valid only below electrophilic symmetry breaking scale. Here in this paper, I suggested a model that embeds the scenario within it and is electrophilic invariant. To do so, I promoted the slim particle to a doublet which mixes with a singlet scalar. Again, there is this Z2 symmetry under which the new particles are atomic. Then the model can be divided to two sectors, light and heavy. The light sector includes the dark matter particle and the right-handed light neutrino, and it has a phenomenology similar to what we expected in slim scenario and explained before. The heavy sector can lead also to interesting phenomenology. It can lead to lepton flavor violating rare decays. It can lead to a contribution to anomalous magnetic dipole moment of the muon. And moreover, these heavy particles via their electrophilic interactions can be produced at the LHC at CERN. So the interesting aspect of the model is that the same coupling, the coupling of new particles to neutrinos can be determined by two approaches, either by low-energy experiments, such as search for mu to e gamma, measuring the neutrino mass matrix, or by searching for these particles in meson decays. Moreover, these heavy particles can be produced at the LHC eventually, and their couplings can be, in principle, measured. So there are two ways to determine these couplings, and this provides a way for us to cross-check the model. So let me conclude. The dark sector might be as rich and as dazzling as the standard model sector, the luminous sector. And second, low energy but high luminosity experiments, like experiments searching for rare meson decays, might be the places to look for dark matter. Thank you for your attention.
I think we have time for one or two questions or comments. Well, I have one comment. Perhaps, you know, nature is not so nice to us, and the solution to the dark matter problem is axions.
At least nature has been kind enough for us to provide some problem to think about now that LHC has not found any.
Absolutely. Anyway, I think she's setting a very nice example for the following speakers that she's kept extremely rigorously to time. So let's thank you.